We have been looking at the story of a young man by the name of Jacob. Before I continue, if some of y'all are wondering, what am I doing with this lace handkerchief? I apologize. I forgot mine and I asked my wife, did she have a handkerchief? I thought she had a white handkerchief. So if you see me wiping with lace, I'm still the same person. Amen. I have not crossed over. Oh Lord. Our scripture for our direction and for our discussion for a few minutes comes again out of Genesis chapter 32 and verses 22 to 32, but I'm not going to read all those verses, but I would like for you, when you get home sometime before the sun sets this evening, to read this encounter. It will bless you. Genesis, the 32nd chapter, verses 22 to 32. I'm just going to maybe, well, I'll read a couple of the following verses. Let us all stand. And I'm reading from the RSV, the Revised Standard Version. Genesis, the 32nd chapter, beginning in verse 22. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome." I'm going to stop right there. You may be seated. I was thinking about a thought that a theologian years ago, in terms of this text, he said, And you will get the implication of it later on down the line, but he said, to go up, you must come down. And if you're down, you will go up. I love the Old Testament. And the reason why I love the Old Testament is because the Old Testament teaches lessons that are implemented and become practical in life in the New Testament. The Old Testament is pointing to the New Testament. And God did not have an Old Testament because there was nothing else to do. These are stories of men and women who struggled with God as we struggle with God along our pilgrim journey. Let's review for just a couple of minutes, Jacob. We talked about the dysfunction of Jacob's family last Sunday. You remember? And you know, the word dysfunction means something that is out of order, is broken, it needs to be fixed, something that is going contrary to God's plan and God's design. And we know that God created the family, amen? And because he created the family is the nucleus. It is the hub of civilization that causes, well, that gives values, principles, because God, through the family, he teaches us what to do, how to do it, how to love one another, how to interact. And when you come to the New Testament, you have the birth of the church. And the church is nothing but the spiritual body of Jesus Christ, which mirrors the family in the Old Testament. For the element of love has to be implanted in both. Love in the family, and then love in the body of Christ. Let me give you a few ingredients, a few problems that Jacob had in his house, not home. Because you know there's a difference between a house and a home. I'm sure you're aware of that. The problem in Jacob's house, first of all, there was greed. There was deceit, pride, favoritism. There was arrogance, selfishness, haughtiness, self-reliance, scheming, vindictiveness, overconfident, and self-justification. Now, when you look at all that and put it together, that just about covers the majority of the sins in the Bible, doesn't it? One way or another. Jacob, and let me say this, because the scripture gives us his indication, Jacob was a mama's boy. His brother Esau was his daddy's favorite. And I don't have time to go into what happened, but there was a encounter at home between Jacob and Esau, between Rebekah, his mother, and Isaac, his father, that eventually they clashed and it exploded. Jacob stole the birthright of his brother Esau and also stole his blessing. And he did it in a deceiving way, in a subterfuge way. He did it in a dishonoring way. And Jacob knew what he was doing. It wasn't that he was not aware of his actions, but he knew what and why he was doing this. Well, naturally, Esau got angry because especially, and it didn't bother Esau so much by giving away his birthright, but when it came to that blessing, Esau really got angry because you see, the birthright meant that basically Jacob would acquire all of the inheritance that Esau would have gotten because he was the firstborn. The blessing meant that God would multiply Esau and that he would be a conqueror over all of his enemies. And because he lost that, he decided, I'm going to kill my brother. So Rebekah said, I want you to leave and I want you to go to my brother in Haran, his name was Laban, until your brother Esau cools down, and after a couple of days or maybe a couple of weeks, then I'll call for you, you can come back. But she didn't know, neither did Jacob know, when he left his mother, he would not get back to that house. It would take 20 years for Jacob, for God to redirect his life. His mother would be dead. He would never see her face again. His father would be dead. He would never see his face again. He leaves home, and let's walk with him on this journey. As he is going to Haran, he gets tired and he stops at a place called Bethel, which means the house of God. God gave him a vision, and this vision was to encourage Jacob, to strengthen him, because God knew what lie ahead for Jacob. He saw a ladder, and that ladder had angels coming down and angels going up. God was at the top of the ladder. God reminded Jacob the covenant that he had made consequently with his grandfather Abraham, and also renewed it with his father Isaac, that I'm going to bless you. You are going to be the father of many families. In fact, there will be so many people coming out of you that it will be just like the grains of sand on the sea or particles of dust in the ground. And if you can't count them, then this is in terms of how many that are going to come out of your loins. Also, you are going to be what? Great. You're going to have a lot of wealth, a lot of riches. All right. So he reestablishes his blessing with Jacob as he had done with Jacob's daddy and Jacob's grandfather. Jacob at Bethel does something which is at this point a part of his inner nature. Jacob is a trickster. He's a scammer. And you're familiar with that term, scammer, because that word is very prevalent in our culture today. A scammer is what? An individual who takes advantage of other folk in order to gain riches, power, and whatever the case might be. If Jacob was living today, and I'm sure they would catch him, he would go to jail and he would stay there for the rest of his life. Jacob tried to bargain with God at Bethel. And he told God, if you do what you promised you're going to do for me, then after I see what you have done, then I will be what? Faithful to you, and I will tithe a tenth of all that you have given to me. Do you see the contradiction in what he said to God and the inconsistency of his nature? In other words, God, I don't really trust you. I don't really believe what you said. So I'm going to watch you, and if your word comes true, then I will what? Trust you. Then I will believe in you. Then I will obey you. This echoes the sentiment of some believers today, that Lord, you got to prove yourself to me. You got to show me that you are really going to keep your word. And you know what? Now think about it. Think about it just from a practical standpoint. Why does God have to prove himself to us? Just think about it. Why would God have to prove himself to you? You don't know when God is lying or not. And if he does lie, what can you do to him to punish him for lying to you? Think about it. You trust him or you don't trust him. Now, everything in life is what? A trust. It has a trust factor in it. We trust folk in our family. Husbands trust wives. Wives trust husbands. Parents trust children. Children trust parents. And you can go on and on. Sometimes that trust is what? It's broken. It's trampled on. That trust is negated, but still you have to live by trust. For if you don't trust anything or anybody, that's a miserable life, which means that you are suspicious of everything that's going on around you. And that also will possibly include your own family. He leaves Bethel. He finally arrives at Uncle Laban's house in Haran. Haran is in Mesopotamia. That's where God called Abraham first. And he told him, I'm going to give you the land of Canaan. So Jacob is leaving Canaan, going back home. where it originated. When he gets there, Jacob doesn't know that his uncle is a greater trickster than he is. Tricksters and scammers always, let me say it like this. I don't care how smart you are, one time in your life, you're going to meet somebody who's smarter than you are. And I don't care what tricks you do, there's always somebody that knows your tricks and knows some more tricks that you don't know. Jacob wanted, well, Laban had two daughters. He had Rachel, he had Leah. Jacob was smitten by Rachel as soon as he saw her. In fact, the boy just, she blew his little mind. And he was just like a little puppy dog, I would say, behind her. And he went to his uncle and he said, I want her for a wife. And he said, okay, you give me 7 years of labor, you can have her. He worked 7 years, supposed to have been getting Rachel. His uncle tricked him. And on the night that he was supposed to have consummated with Rachel, he looked up the next morning, it was Leah, the older daughter. And Jacob said, wait a minute, I didn't work 7 years for Leah. You know I wanted Rachel. Oh, well, it is the custom, Laban said, in our country that the older girl get married first before the younger girl. So if you want my younger daughter, you got to give me 7 more years. The trickster got tricked. But because he loved Rachel, he worked 7 more years, 14 years all total. But then at the end, so we can get to our text, at the end when he got ready to leave and go back home where he thought his mother and father were still living, he pulled a trick on his uncle. Both of them were tricking one another. Crazy family. And you know what? I've seen families like that today. Just like that today. Anyway, when Jacob got through tricking his uncle in terms of breeding his stock, his sheep and his goats, Jacob ended up being wealthy and having more stock than his uncle had. Jacob got his wives, got all of his servants, got his camels, his goats, his sheep, and left without telling his uncle that he was gone. He snuck out by night. And he didn't know that Rachel, his wife, had gotten, there were idol gods in her daddy's house that she stole and took with her, but Jacob didn't know about it. And when his uncle found out, and of course his uncle didn't get upset about Jacob tricking him in terms of multiplying his stock and everything, his flock. But when he found out that his idol gods had been stolen, and he didn't know who did it, that infuriated him. So he took out after Jacob, and he pursued him, caught him. And Jacob knew nothing about this. And Jacob told his uncle, in essence, if you find the gods, I apologize. I don't know anything about it. And I will what? I will repay you for what damage has been done. Well, what Rachel did, she hid the gods under the camel that she was riding on. So she was sitting on those gods up under that camel. And her daddy looked everywhere, couldn't find the gods nowhere because she, his daughter, was sitting on his gods. When he didn't find it, he apologized to Jacob. And he said to Jacob, okay, this is the dividing line. You go your way, in essence, I'll go my way. And the two of us were parted, not as enemies, but as friends. So now Jacob, not too far from home. And you would think after God has reassured him at Bethel that I'm with you, I'm going to bless your life, I'm going to carry you through any storm that the choir was singing about. And I'm going to bring you safely to where you should be. And I'm not going to leave you until I have accomplished in and through you my purpose. He starts thinking about Esau. And he doesn't know, after all these years, the attitude of his older brother. But he still thinks Esau wants to kill him. So one night, he decides that he's going to try to bribe Esau. So he divides his family. And you got to remember, in that time, families were maids and servants, wives, this sort of thing. He divided his family and he sent one group ahead of the other group. And they had sheep and goats and camels. And he said now to the servant, when you get to Esau, this is what you say. My lord Esau, your servant Jacob sends these gifts, as so to speak, and hoping that you will accept them from him. Do you notice the language that he used? Esau, my lord, Jacob, his servant, because he's scared. So he doesn't want it to appear to Esau that he's still brazen and arrogant, you know. He didn't say, my lord to your lord. In other words, I'm scared of you, so I'm going to humble myself if you will accept this gift from me and let bygones be bygones. Finally, he sends his wives, Rachel and Leah, his maids, he sends them over the brook. And the narrator tells us that it's night. And bad things can happen at night. He's alone. His wives are gone. His children, and by the way, he's got 11 boys. Well, those wives of his, they were really breeding. Everybody is gone now. Jacob is by himself. The writer tells us that there was a man that wrestled with Jacob all night long. When the sun started coming up, the man told Jacob, turn me loose. Jacob said, I will not release you until you bless me. The man broke Jacob's hip. But in spite of all that pain, he still clung to the man. So the man asked him, what is your name? Names in that day meant something. They don't mean nothing now. Names are just poetic, you know, beauty now. But names in those days implied the character of the person. And he said, my name is Jacob, which means what? Trickster, schemer, scammer, liar. And he said to him, your name will no longer be Jacob now, but it will be changed to what? Israel. You're no longer a trickster, a schemer, a scammer. Now God is going to what? He's going to deal with you differently and change your attitude and your personality. Now, Jacob learned lessons in his encounter with God. The question I raise in this text, what can aid us? What can we learn through Jacob's struggle in terms of our faith struggle? Three things I'm going to recommend. Others, you can read the context for yourself. The first thing that I am suggesting that Jacob learned that will benefit us in our struggle is that the blessing that Jacob received from God comes not to those that are well-meaning people, but to those that are desperate and at the end of their rope. Let me repeat that again, because that's long, ain't it? The blessing that Jacob got doesn't come to persons who are content, satisfied with their faith, but it comes to those who are desperate in their lives, and that they have reached, as so to speak, the end of their rope. They have tried everything and nothing worked. They are still in confusion and their lives is still misery. We are living in a culture right now where people are trying to find the purpose of life, the answer to life, through drugs, alcohol, achievements, power, disposition, entitlement, you name it. They're trying to find it. But they don't realize these things that man gives you, they are temporary things. They don't last. They evaporate. Like when the sun comes out and there's fog, and when the sun hits the fog, it leaves. Amen? The only purpose in life that will ground you and give you a sense of your well-being is God. And it doesn't matter about what age you are. There are many of us in here that we surrendered our lives when we were young. We came up maybe in a religious home, whether it was a parent, mother, father, grandparents, I don't know. But they talked to us about God. We were young. And what they said to us, we really didn't understand, but we trusted them because of their faith walk and the experience that they had with God. So we surrendered, came to the church, and we use the term, joined the church, baptized. But then as we started getting older, we started to questioning our faith. Amen? And we realized that what we had surrendered to when we were younger, we really didn't understand what we were doing. Let me say it another way. We had not had an experience like Jacob at Jabbok. We had accepted God on the word of some other saint. Let me say it like this. If you are going to have a strong faith, you got to struggle. And it's got to be your faith and not somebody else's faith. They can tell you what they have gone through or what God has taken them through, but the final analysis is it must come to you the same way. Pain, sorrow, disappointment. That's how you come to find out if God is real, if he keeps his word, if he will bless you, if he says in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to them that have been called according to his purpose. How do you know? I ask you the question. You can recite that verse. It sounds good when you are giving it to somebody else. But what? When you are going through your valley, what does that verse mean to you? And what if somebody came to you and recited the same verse?
How will you receive it in your spirit? Jesus told Nicodemus one day, he said, don't say nothing. Jesus told Nicodemus one day, you must be born again. Let me say it another way. You individually must know God personally for yourself. And it has nothing to do with joining the church. You cannot have a personal experience with God joining the church. In fact, you can receive God into your life and never don the building of a church. Did you know that? The problems that we are encountering in our culture today is, I feel, because we don't have authenticity in terms of Christian walks. We have a lot of people who embrace institutional Christianity, but they know nothing about biblical Christianity. The church is not going to enter the kingdom of God. I'm talking about the building. This ain't going to heaven. It is individual souls that are going to heaven that God will receive. And the only way, he says, you can get in the 14th chapter of John, you got to come by him. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man, nobody, you can be President Obama, you can be a senator, a representative, it doesn't matter. You can be a judge on the Supreme Court. You don't get in heaven but by and acknowledging me. Number two. A person has to recognize and accept the fact that only God can satisfy their soul. You have to recognize that. But recognizing it and not accepting it is two different actions. Recognizing is acknowledging the fact, yes, it looks like he's the answer to my life. But then accepting his answer and living by it is two different things. Why do you think so many Christian marriages are being dissolved today? Do you know that the divorce rate for Christian marriages is higher than the divorce rate for those who are not Christians? Something is wrong, isn't it? I would say there's a problem. And I don't think it has to do a lot with counseling either. I think it starts with the individual person, and if they are authentically connected and linked with Jesus Christ. Let me say it the old folks' way. If they don't know Jesus, then you can repeat and verbalize all the creeds of the church, which mean nothing unless Christ is in your heart. Because Satan can verbalize creeds. You got to reach out to God like a drowning man that clutches at a straw. Scripture says there's a way that seems right to a person, but the end of it is what? Death and destruction. There are a lot of things in life that seem good to people. Drugs seem good. I talked with a man yesterday, and he told me that he had had several operations and that he had a defibrillator in his heart, and that when the doctors put that defibrillator in, or whatever, I think that's what you call it, isn't it? Defibrillator? Anyway, No, it wasn't a pacemaker. Yeah, it was something. Well, anyway, to keep his heart going. And he said the doctors gave him 17% chance that he would live. But he was there talking to me. Anyway, he said, I'm a Jew. And I said to him, I'm a Christian. Now our conversation began, like Jesus approached a woman at the well. And we started talking. And he told me he started out, he was a policeman. Then he went from that occupation to driving an 18-wheeler truck. Then from that occupation, he went into business. He's an entrepreneur now. And he said that he hires about 100 drivers. And he was talking about the money that he made and blah, blah, blah. And he was talking about what had happened to him and that he used to be on drugs and alcohol and this sort of thing. But he said to me, I asked him this. I said, do you attend your synagogue on a regular basis? He said, and then he tried to change the subject. And I said, I asked you a question. You haven't answered my question. How often do you go to your synagogue? And he said, finally, he said, well, maybe once in every 3 or 4 years. I said, oh, okay, all right. I said, what would be the goal of your life that if you died tonight, you would be satisfied that your life was worthwhile? And he gave me 3 things, and I thought about it. Happiness, love, and God. And I thought to myself, this old man, he's on the ball. When you look at it, the Bible lifts up those same 3 ingredients. They tell us that without Jesus, you can't be happy, right? Without Jesus, there's no love, because he teaches us how to love. And ultimately, God has to be what? The final analysis in your life. I don't care when you were praying. When I was coming up, they told me, mom and daddy told me, if you want a wife, pray for a wife. That don't exist today. You go to a computer, it takes the place of God and it gives you a wife. If mom and dad were living today, I don't know whether they would agree with that or not. But anyway, that's the way it is. Amen? You know, I talked about it last Sunday. Don't you? But it doesn't matter. The main thing is, do I consult God in every venture and endeavor in my life? Even the minutest thing in my life. Do I ask God, what does he want me to do? Or do I just consult him when there are gigantic storms? But then when the gigantic storms are over with, then I feel as though that I can handle the little small things that come. And then the third and final thing, one has to admit that God ought not to accept them when they come to him. But yet, they cannot refuse a no for an answer. Let me explain. In the 18th chapter of Luke's gospel, Jesus gives a parable. Parable is a story. And it talks about an inopportune widow, woman whose husband had died. And she went to a judge. You remember the story? And she told the judge that she needed the judge to intervene on her behalf because there was some problem. We don't know whether it was property or whatever the case might have been. But she wanted the judge to intervene on her behalf. The judge, in essence, told her, I don't have time. There are other matters that are more important than you. But she kept on coming back. She kept on harassing him. She just kept on bugging him until finally Jesus said in the story, I better do something for this woman because she's going to worry me to death. Then he compared in terms of how man reacts to a plea over against how God reacts to a plea. Now, he said, man, you got to harass him. You got to have some clout or some authority or some power. You got to know somebody who knows somebody. With God, you don't have to do that. You don't have to know nobody. In fact, it's best that you don't know nobody. Because when you go to him, you better go to him alone by yourself. You don't have to harass him and constantly bang on the door of heaven. But if that's what it takes, keep on asking. Because he says, you have not. Why? Because you what? Ask not. And sometimes we get upset because we don't see our petitions answered immediately. But let me tell you, like Jacob, Jabbok broke Jacob. The schemer, the guy who thought he was smarter than anybody else, it crushed Jacob. And before any of us can really surrender to God, he's got to kill you on the inside. You got to come to death before he can give you life. All of that arrogance and pride, your schooling, your degrees, don't mean nothing to God. The money you got in the bank, your 401Ks, don't mean nothing to God. Nothing means nothing to him. Because see, when you get in his heaven, you ain't going to need that stuff. Plus, you're going to have to leave it anyway. And somebody else is going to take it and they're going to enjoy it. You just come to him, humble, like Jacob. Read the prayer before he gets to Jabbok. And his prayer is now, he's not praying and saying, my dad is God. My grandfather's God. He's not saying the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Now he's saying, my God. Oh, a different attitude now. He ain't bargaining with God no more. For he realizes you cannot bargain with God. Because he doesn't need what you have. He doesn't need what you got. But you need everything that he has. So the best thing to do is what? Surrender to him and let him have his way in your life. Then Paul say, he found out that being a Pharisee of the tribe of Benjamin and studying on the Gamaliel and, you know, and all like that in his day, he was a top cat. And he was respected and looked up to. But on the Damascus Road, God knocked him in the dust. A teacher. You don't do that. This is Saul of Tarsus. You don't mess with that man. That man can have you arrested and put in jail for the rest of your life. God still knocked him down. But when God knocked him down, he didn't leave him down. Oh, help me, Lord. That's one thing about my God over against men. Folk will knock you down, kick you down, talk you down. They will tear you down and leave you down. But God will pick you up. And after he got through knocking Saul down, he picked him up, Kenneth. But when he picked him up, he had to show him who did it. And he had to blind him. And can you imagine Saul? And he told him, he said, you go to a street called Straight. The teacher, the Pharisee, the great man was stumbling. Now he's just like a child. Don't know which way to go. But when God got through with him and when God opened his eyes and the scales fell off, then not only did the scales fall off, but something else fell off. His arrogance, his pride, his self-reliance fell with Saul. And because now he's a new man, his name is changed to what? Paul, which means little man but great man. And it doesn't matter about your physical attributes, or it doesn't matter about physically who you are or who you know. When God comes into your life, he can handle anything that comes and goes. The story of Jacob is not the story of a bad man becoming good or a good man getting bad. It is the story of God entering the life of this man and making him who he wants him to be. That's what Jobbik is all about. And all of us in our life, if you have not had a Jobbik, you will. If you have been faking it for a long time, just keep living a little bit longer. If you can, try to live a few more decades, and sooner or later God will knock you down. Oh, believe me, he will. And he doesn't have to get your permission to break you. He'll break you by snatching from you somebody that you love, that's right, and that's in your heart, and he'll rip it out. Amen. He'll take away something from you that your life was wrapped around, and he'll rip it, snatch it away from you. And there's nothing you can do about it. He'll put you out of control of your own life. And you'll start doing things that you used to laugh at other people doing, but now you're doing the same thing. You're bowing to him. He's a great God. Oh, Lord. I wouldn't take anything from having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, he doesn't promise that you're going to be rich, that you're going to be a millionaire. No, no. He just says that whatever you go through in your life, I'm going to be right there with you, Cleaster. Can you stand? Yes. Your legs ain't too bad off, are they? No. He said, whatever you're going through, I'm with you. He didn't say, Cleaster, see that down there? There are riches at the end. Go ahead and I'll meet you later on. I got something else I got to do. No. He doesn't abandon us. For he says in Hebrews 13:5, I'll never leave you, neither will I forsake you. And now he didn't say that I'm going to guide you around the storm, or I'm going to lift you up like a helicopter over the storm. He just says, I'll be there with you in the storm. What a better friend can you have than Jesus in the storm? Because I don't know about you, but I have had family in the storm, and they were in worse shape than I was in the storm. They couldn't help me, and I couldn't help them. And both of us were blubbering in the storm. But then when I gave it to Jesus, he worked it out. And you don't have to live to be 80 or 90 to find out that Jesus will work it out. I found that out when I was 21 years of age. He'll knock you down so many ways. Ah, Lord. The invitation for discipleship is extended. The way up is down. You get it? The way up is down. And the only way that you can get up, you have to be down. Now the question is this morning, where are you on the plane of your life? You still trying different methods. You still, there are things coming and going that you are confronted with and you're confused about. Let me say that Jesus died on a cross. He died for one reason, that my soul. You see, a lot of folk don't think that they have a soul. But your soul doesn't die when the dust goes back in the ground. Amen. Souls don't die. Souls are eternal. And the question that he died for is that, what are you going to do with your soul? Where will your soul spend eternity? Now, you know what eternity is. Eternity is that which never ends. It goes on and on. Now, he says, your soul is, you make the decision in this life whether your soul will be with him or whether it's going to be in hell. And it's very simple. It's that you don't have to know rocket science to understand that. And the decision has to be an individual decision. It can't be a group decision. It can't be voted on. No democracy in this. You either accept him or you don't accept him. You either do it your way and play your life out. Then at the end, if it's too late, that was a decision that you made. But if you want him to hold you and to guide you and to walk with you, that decision has to be made by you. And joining a church, that's not the decision. Being baptized, that's not a decision. You must decide on him before all of that takes place. That's just icing on the cake. But it means nothing if before that time, Jesus Christ, you have not surrendered to him and you have not taken him into your heart. To me, it's simple. But we wrestle with our humanity and what I want and the way that I see it and how I feel about it. And God don't give a barrel of beans about how I feel and what I think. Because in the end, when I die, I don't want to be with question marks over my head. I want to know in that last moment when I breathe my last breath that I'm going to be what? In the glory of my Lord. I'm going to see him and I'm going to hear him. And all of this down here won't matter no more. You know, I say sometimes my wife and I discuss this and we say, you know, why did God permit this to happen? Or why did God direct that to happen? And I said to her sometimes, I said, you know what? Some answers God is not going to give us in this life. You have to live with what he gives to you, what he shows you, and then walk by faith for the rest of it. For Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, and then the things that he chooses to reveal to us and our children. And if you don't choose to reveal it, then you just what? You trust them. If he chooses not to give you an answer, you still got to trust him because he knows what's best. May we stand. The doors of the kingdom, his kingdom, the doors are open. Whosoever will, let them come.
I was shackled by a heavy burden beneath the load of guilt and shame. But then the hands of Jesus touched me, and now I'm no longer the same. Oh,
he touched me.
Touch me.
Oh, yes, he did.
And oh, the joy that floods my soul. I don't know about you, but something happened And now, right now, I know, ooh, he touched me, and he made me whole.
I surrender.
Oh, he was there all the time.
Oh, yes.
He was there. Oh, in your body, he was there. Oh, all the time when your sister's foot got to be amputated, waiting so patient, he was waiting so patiently in line. He was there. 19 years of my life going through my family with cancer, he was there. Y'all gonna go through something too. He'll be there. I know he will. Oh, all the time. Oh, yes.
Yes, yes.
He was there.
All the time.
All the time. My God was there. All the time. So many burdens in my life. So many trials. So many tribulations. Waiting so patiently.
Yes. Oh yes, going on. Those storm clouds rise. On every hand. I feel like oh yes. I hear Paul make the statement, when I am weak, that's when I'm strong. I want to have a brief altar prayer now. Been told that Sister Kimberly Sims lost her grandbaby last night. Her daughter lost their child. So we want to pray for her daughter. And if there are any other storms and trials that are pervading the lives of anyone here now, I'm going to ask that you would come as we join at the altar and lift our petitions. For James tells us the faithful, fervent prayers of the righteous availeth much, accomplish a great deal. God does hear and he does answer prayer. Sometimes not the way that we want our prayers answered. But even when he says no, he's answering your prayer. When he says wait, or if there's a delay, he's answering the prayer. Naturally in the flesh, we want him to say yes to all of our requests. But God knows what's best for us. Nobody in the flesh likes to suffer pain, bewilderment, discontent. Physically, we all want to be happy, feel good. But life is not that story from the cradle to the grave. We never know in terms of when we're going to be ambushed by a trial. When something's going to happen out of the blue, we didn't even know about or even anticipate. And you got to have somebody to call on. And if mom and daddy are gone, and if those that you thought were strong in their faith, if they are gone, who are you going to call on? I would say to you, call on Jesus. He will hear your prayer. Let us now bow our heads, join our hearts together. For all of us need the power of God to use us in our lives. Dear Father in heaven, first of all, we thank you that you've chosen us to be your vessels of outreach, to share and to spread the word about Jesus Christ, that he came, he died, he was buried, and on the third day he got up out of the grave with all power in his hands. He's the author of life, the architect of life, the sustainer of life, the keeper of life. He is the end of life. And he is the lover of our souls. We come, Father, to say thank you. You've brought all of us, even though